Hey guys, I'm Casey Armstrong. This is WMAP, the world's most amazing people.
Host Casey Armstrong has a really good heart, and I think he actually really cares what the people have to say. And I think that the idea has been great, and all these people have the opportunity to really share their stories and get their word out. I love WMAP because I hear stories that inspire me.
I happen to be of the belief that everyone, doesn't matter what it is, it's how you look at it. This is WMAP, the world's most amazing people.
Guys, hey, it's Kelly. Hope everyone's doing good and having a great day. Hope everyone went out and voted. I know it's, you know, gets very busy, but it's important that everyone goes out there and votes. And I know Casey has a lot to say about the voting experience coming up later on in the show. But first, I have a guest with us, a really great guest who's returning to the show. I'm really excited to speak with him and for you guys to get to hear him. So I have Desirel Calvin Lawrence. He's an author, web designer, and speaker. Hey, Desirel, how are you doing?
I'm doing bad. I'm doing well. I'm doing just fine.
That's great. I'm so glad to get to speak to you and have you on the show today. I wanted to start out by asking, since it's been a little while that we've had you on the show, if you can start out by telling our listeners a little bit about yourself.
Well, I wear different hats, so it might be very hard to put that in perspective, but I'm the author of The Power of Paradise. That's how I started. I started that in 2008, and probably after quite a number of interesting experiences I had. But when I wrote The Power of Paradise in 2008, I forgot about the book, didn't really do much about it until later on when I said, all right, let me really touch on this book because it helps you really invent the future with a choice, and it gives you choices within it to make a difference. So that's a nutshell about me. I'm into IT, extremely into IT, and, you know, and a lot of things. So briefly, I do a number of things that I love. I do music. I do a lot of things, really.
Now, you said you're into IT. How did you get your start doing that?
Oh, well, I went to college, actually. I went to college for quite some time and did a lot of designing. Pretty much. That was my curriculum was actually based on information systems. So I pretty much went into web designing for a while and mastered a little bit of the trade. At least I'm not the best coder, but I do a lot on the design level. And so that helps me a lot. And it goes back since 2001. So I'm kind of familiar with quite a number of environments when it comes to the web. Yeah.
Wow, that's incredible. Now, and I know you've had some other pretty big ideas and things that you've tried to patent. What about OxySmokes? What was that, and what was that all about?
Yeah, well, OxySmokes, that's interesting. And it comes down to the, you know, you look at a book, I'm talking about inventing the future with a choice. The streak with inventions has been with me for a while. In 1999... I came up with a number of very interesting ideas that just made me want to go patent it and get something doing with it. You know, I just want to do something with it. And I came up with OxySmokes because I was like, how all these people that smoke cigarettes, is there a better way where we can give them something better to smoke? Mm-hmm. And so that was why I came up with OxySmokes. It was more like something like oxygen, but a better kind of oxygen, you know. But so that's how OxySmokes came on. And I had quite a number of different ideas I came up with, like magnets. And magnets, and that was in 1999. And there's a reason why I'm saying this, because magnet is pretty much what you have as a tablet.
Oh, okay.
But instead of a tablet, you know, it's related to something complete, a different niche entirely. And I was thinking about the flip screen with the hand, the finger, and all that. And I was like, this could be a great idea. And that was one of the few things I wanted a patent. There's quite a number of ones, a number of them that I was looking into patent. I probably will go into that some other time, but those are just a few of the things I was trying to patent in 99. I just didn't have the means, I didn't have the money, and I was just hauled down by ideas pretty much. But you know, time changes things, and you know, I've come to a point where I realize it's ideas don't mean anything if you hold it to yourself. You have to give it away somehow if you don't do something with it. So, but yeah. Oh, some of them's gonna actually do it eventually. So that's actually what's gonna happen eventually.
Yeah.
You know. But yeah.
Of course. Now you mentioned oxy smokes, and you mentioned that it was like oxygen. Is that at all similar to what now the big trend is with these vaporizers or vapes or the e-cigarettes?
Exactly. I didn't know how to fully conceptualize it at that time, but I already knew what it was going to do. It was going to just be clean smoke that actually gave you a high that was pure and didn't actually affect the body. So that was the idea of oxy smokes, because again, it comes from oxygen, you know, but maybe a higher level of oxygen or something like that. But it was supposed to be based on cigarettes, an alternative to cigarettes. But that was a while back. That was pretty much like 20 years ago. And you know, and that's why I say ideas, at the end of the day, you can hold it. But somebody's actually thinking about it. Eventually, somebody, the world is going to place it in the arms of somebody who can bring it to the light or bring it to the public. Because if you hold it in, you either die with it, or somebody more passionate about that idea. Because I think it's a gift, mm-hmm. or it's a talent, or it's some stroke of luck that is being placed in your hands. And if you don't do anything with it, the universe takes it away from you.
Yeah.
Like it's to somebody who does something with it. And so, you know, and maybe your time was just not right at that point, you know, and things just happened that, you know, it's there, but it's just supposed to plant the seed for future opportunities, you know. So, yeah, but that is oxy smokes. That was oxy smokes. I had magnets. I had quite a number of few. I probably have to dig in my patent box to figure out all those ones I was thinking of pulling out. But I still have many ideas I've come up with just of recent, and it's kind of interesting how these things happen. But yeah, oxy smokes was quite interesting. That I see it now. I see magnet with tablets, and I'm like, you need to do something with your ideas or sell something, and somebody else is gonna get going with it as soon as possible. You know.
Yeah, of course. Now, with the ideas that you've had, were you able to take them to the next phase, or were they just really in the idea process?
Well, probably, hopefully, we get to that point when I talk to you about that. I have definitely a couple of ideas that I'm trying to put into the limelight, and one of them right now is what I would probably discuss later on when we get to that point. And this is, again, it's revealed on new clay, so I'll probably talk about that in new clay. But I wanted to be able to at least give a little understanding of why I might have something to offer that might make sense. And this comes, you know, I wanted to pull back to 2013.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to mention names or anything like that. But in 2013, I was going on the internet, and I figured out something that was quite interesting. And, you know, those very simple things you look at that you're like, all right, if this can be done, why can't it be done in this way? It seems like, so I looked at this particular media environment, and I was like, you know, something can be done to make it more collaborative. And the next thing you know, I put the idea together. I wrote everything. I wrote the script, and I shot it out to this very interesting individual that ran the company itself, ran the social empire. And I was like, you know what? Why don't you do this? You know, it makes sense to do these things. And this comes from having ideas and not doing anything with it.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know, and there's somebody else doing it. I was like, you know what? Why can't I just for it out there, you know. And I didn't even think about it like that. I just thought about it. And I was like, the guy is a very interesting person, very interesting, prolific individual. I'm like, why not? Just give it to him. He's already a very good person by my judgment. So, like, you know, why not just give it to him? So I looked at it, and I sent it up. And within a couple of years, that very idea got implemented on the system across board. And, you know, it didn't occur to me that, you know, the idea had been implemented. I just realized that, oh, I remember sharing this with this. And then it caught me, oh, okay, yeah. And then I looked at I said, okay, that definitely did happen. So I was kind of impressed with the fact that they did take the advice. And I was like, you know, it helps put me in a better light in terms of how I pursue things, you know, to know that definitely your ideas have value. And it's not so much about money, mm-hmm. as opposed to being able to share something that might have a positive impact down the line in the lives of people that are already doing things to empower the world.
Yes, no, I completely agree with you. And I wanted to ask also, because I know that you had made some contributions to social media, and I wanted to ask about that. And I know you, there's some things you can talk about and there's some things that you can't talk about, but I think social media is such a big part of pretty much everybody's existence today. So I wanted to ask you about that.
Yeah, and so it makes sense, Aunt Kelly. And so I maybe jumped ahead, but that was really what, that was the right way to look at it. That was the social media situation I was talking about. And it was the social media environment. Without talking about the specifics of it, it was just an opportunity for me to look at a situation that had not yet developed. But it was also an opportunity that a business could take advantage of, that I felt like at this point, if you don't understand the power of what you can do with this, mm-hmm. you don't want somebody else doing it before you do it. Because, you know, it was like, I looked at it from an aspect of global interaction and the how to balance the cost of connection in such a way that you can actually do much more and do much more with little resources. And I was looking at that and I was like, that could be great. And so when I shared it, and like I said, a couple of years later, last year, I was like, oh, you know, and I'm not usually on the internet that much. So when I see certain things, I'm like, this might make sense to this. That is when I realized that, wow, it got implemented. And so I said it with my friend, and I was like trying to prove that was what happened. And then I had to go back and take up my email and show the person, all right, this is what happened. You know, you won't believe it. So don't take my ideas lightly. So I was just using it as a way to interact with this individual. But that was the reason why I even went back to retrieve that information, because I wanted to, you know, try to listen to the idea. My idea might have some import to what you're doing. So don't undermine it, because other people listen to it. So it was a way of, you know, trying to make a point. And that's why I actually retrieved the information, and I would have actually forgotten about it.
Wow, that's so crazy. You know, it's funny how, you know, we get these ideas and, you know, and they're such amazing and big ideas. And then before we know it, you know, we're kind of seeing them all around us before, you know, we can even really fully, I guess, we can really even fully form it. I don't know if you can agree with me on that.
No, I do. I do. I definitely agree with you. I really do agree with you. And it takes a team to actually pull an idea together. Like, for example, WMAP Radio, you know, it takes a team. You know, the idea was probably fleshed out and was like, this is great, but it took a team. And without that team that to give it form, it won't come alive. You know what I mean?
Yes, I definitely
do. And so the same thing with an idea, you know, everything needs a team. And if you're not positioned to create the team or gather those very loyal or resourceful individuals around you, you are actually dead in your tracks.
Yeah, of course.
Nothing happens, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's is amazing how sometimes an idea comes, and the best way I've learned over time is to share it. You know, however simply you share it, however subtly you share it, when I say subtly, you know, in a subtle way,
yes.
You sharing it is important because you might find people who have kindred spirit with you while sharing it, who can identify with a vision and go the distance with you in creating that thing or creating that idea or making a feasible possibility in the world. And so that's the way I look at it. And so I've gotten to the point where when I have an idea, even if I don't share the whole thing, I share enough so that I can have a conversation going, get a feedback, brainstorm. Sometimes you can't brainstorm alone. You have to shoot it back with somebody to get a good insight into what you're trying to do. And so that's what I've ended up doing with ideas that I feel inspired by or connected to.
Yeah, and now as we spoke about inventions and just, you know, brainstorming and getting these ideas, something that's really important when you want to create something and you want to really get it out there is branding. Branding is crucial, really,
yeah.
to bringing
yeah.
something to market and to getting people to really hear about it. And
yeah.
I know that is something else that you have kind of going on in your world. And I wanted to ask you about this branding medium that that you kind of have going on. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, the branding. I know the last time I was on air, I spoke about name remodification. And it's a crucial element to nearly everything you see in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Not name remodification itself, but naming, just the idea of naming. And everyone gets named one time or the other in their life, you know, probably when you're born. You know, if you probably never got a name when you're born, then there must be something wrong, you know.
Yeah.
So everyone has a name. But what I came to find out after doing extensive research was names have a way of defining the person and defining their destiny.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's kind of strange that why is it that two companies do the same thing, but yet one is more successful than the other? You know, you have a lot of that
in
the world we live in.
Mm-hmm.
They do exactly the same thing, but one is much more refined, much more resourceful, doing a lot more. Better than the next person. How does that happen? And I looked at it and I researched extensively on this, and I realized that everything in this universe follows a mathematical principle. And that means if you go out on the street, everything follows a principle that is mathematical,
mm-hmm.
maybe in the United States at least. And if you go to every civilized world and every world that is developed, even those that are not developed, you will realize there's a trend that is connected to mathematical intelligence that makes anything they do succeed if it were to succeed. And that means if I chose to do something and it's supposed to succeed, I have to use something that is based on a mathematical principle, a mathematical science that aligns this in proper synergy. And take that to the digital world we live in today. Everything is digitized. But to the very core of that very core of that digital world is a mathematical principle. The binary numbers of ones and zeros, it is so consistent in everything that seems to be perfect in the digital world. And you take that to other realms of science and everything boils down to mathematical principles. So what is it in a name that could literally transform somebody? When I say two companies do the same thing, yet one is much more better and much more loved than the next, what is it that makes them different? And I came down to the science of names. And it's interesting how everything has a vibrational energy to it. Mm-hmm. From the clothes you wear to the food you eat, everything has a vibrational energy to it. And I explained to you that when you were born, everyone was born. When they called you, you never really answered to that name immediately. Subconsciously, you probably were fighting that name before you eventually realized, this sound keeps coming at me. Let me turn in that direction. So what was taking your concentration before that time, when you were a kid or when you were young, that you wouldn't turn until eventually you managed to tune your vibrations to that sound and respond to it? That defines your destiny.
Yeah, and that's really interesting, too. I mean, I wonder if part of it has to do with repetition, like especially when you're, you know, at that real young age and, you know, as you said, you don't know what your name is and you're starting to learn it. And not to compare humans to dogs, but I know when, you know, you get a new dog and you get it used to its new name, it's the repetition. They get used to hearing that sound and they see, you know, how you're interacting with it.
Yes. Yes. And that's where the energy comes in, you know. Mm-hmm. Sound carries an energy to it. You know, if I said, probably, maybe if I put it, maybe it's supposed to go in, maybe some hertz or something like that, and it's going in a particular wavelength towards you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you understand sound has wavelengths to it, you know, that travel in the air before it reaches you. And the same thing goes with music. You listen to music, it carries sound waves that travels to you, and then you react to it. You're either happy, you're either joyous, you're either, you know, angry, you're either sad, you're either melancholic. There could be so many different emotions that could describe different kinds of music. Mm-hmm. I mean, you look at a name, even though it's so short and brief, it's a musical wave that could be defining how you respond down the line. Defining how people respond to you down the line. So what kind of music is this person? You know, you said, let me just put it in that symbolic way. What kind of music is this person? What kind of, that is life, you know. It's everything is like, again, it's mathematical. And you're like, yeah, I connect with this person. But what kind of music is playing when you call out that person's name? And how are you responding? Because again, that same name is repeated over and over around a person. It completely defines the energy around a person.
Mm-hmm.
So what music is it playing? You know, and that is Brandon. And so, and when I look at it, I talk about kind of the VIPs of the future. And that's exactly my dream, because I've got to the point where I realize that a lot of people have dreams. They have the perfect skill to get certain things done, but they're not branded to carry that message to the world. They're not branded to carry that vision, because the brand is killing the vision. You see, the brand is not the right music for the vision. That is, maybe it's the name they're using, maybe it's something else, but it's not the right music for the vision. And that's why I when I came upon this science and I studied it extensively, I said, you know what? Maybe I should be in the business of branding the perfect VIP, you know, just that individual that wants to dream beyond their regular dreams. How can I place it? And I'll probably just finish on this note, you know. Again, it's not about money, even though it's going to take money to pull this off.
Yeah.
Because what I'm trying to do is probably on a scale that I probably will be, I'll be extending myself beyond and extending a lot of people beyond their regular hours of the day. But it's not about money, but about the value you have in yourself that we are trying to brand. But the money is going to be very important to pull it off. And this is why I say that. You know, you could be the best person on a skateboard and you don't have any money, but because you have that value, everybody wants to be around you. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely.
You know, you might be the best fighter, might be a karate kid or what, everyone wants to be around you. you might not have a dime. You might have the best musical voice. Not a dime in your hand. But everyone wants to be around you. That is currency. That is the value of interaction. And so I know today we prize money over that kind of value. We want to be with people that have so much, and it's about their possessions that attracts us. But really, what should be attracting us is the value in that person. What is the value? You know, he might have all the money in the world, but have you tried to understand his wisdom? Have you tried to understand other things outside of what he owns?
Mm-hmm.
To really connect with a value. And I think that is what sometimes is missing in society. But that is why the next VIPs or whoever is looking to be branded based on this value system, again, it's going to require quite an investment, but at the end of the day, they will be valued based on who they are or who they represent. Of course, people are going to know them by the end of the day, but they will be able to communicate, hopefully with important people and unimportant people, quote unquote, because everyone is important. Because again, I believe it's all about the value. Not necessarily is the value you have in yourself. Anyone is important if you understand the value within yourself. You can connect with anybody. But this will give you a greater platform to do that. And that's why I was hoping to start this brand and you know, bring it out to the awareness of the public.
Yes, well, yeah. I think it's a very, very interesting idea. And it's not something that I've really heard done before. And I wanted to ask, now, someone who might be interested in this kind of branding, what would come along with that? What kind of things would come along with branding an individual like that?
Okay, so and it's great. I'll try to, you know, first of all, is your name resonating with your complete destiny? Is your name resonating with your vision in life? Is where you want to be in life? Have you been fighting so hard to get there, and you know you have all the skills to do it,
mm-hmm.
but you just are always hitting a roadblock?
Yeah.
What is going on? It's the music you're dancing to. It's the beat. It's the heartbeat of your name that is not in. And I'm sure this might be very unorthodox, completely unorthodox to a lot of people. Like, what is he talking about? What is my name? What's wrong with my name?
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm not. It, you know, it's probably a hard pill to swallow, but there's a lot of scientific truth to this. And what is in that name that is stopping you from reaching your full potential? Why is somebody like, you might look at Jennifer Aniston, for example, quite a number of famous actors and actresses, and you realize that they had name changes before they became who they were.
Mm-hmm.
Tom Cruise wasn't who he was. That was not his name, you know?
Yeah.
Will Smith, Bruce Willis, you know, that was not his, you know? A lot of these great and very prolific actors were not necessarily purveyors of the name they had, that they have right now. They actually had other names. And it took on a new persona with a new name. And it changed. You'd be surprised. They had everything going before that time. Just the name just really trumped it up. Completely trumped it up. So at that point, everything just probably just gelled together. And it became exactly who you actually connect to today. You know? And it goes with other names. You can go to, like I said, in my last, I spoke about rappers that use certain names, and before they were who they were and they turned into the rapper they are today, they're not using their real names. Do you notice that?
Yes, definitely.
That is like, do you notice that most rappers don't use their name? They use a pseudonym. And some of the most successful rappers use pseudonyms to actually create the success they had. And not to say they didn't have the skill. Mm-hmm. They had the skill. They were doing this with their regular names before the time began, maybe. But immediately, probably, they kicked in with a pseudonym, with a cliche that embodied their ideology. They just blew up like crazy. And so what is in a name? And I use that as an example to tell you there is a science to names that creates who you are and the energy of who you are. This is why I was really geared towards creating the next brand and based on this kind of ideology, mm-hmm. but also on something bigger than that, and which I did not want to unveil, but I would. It's still in the works, and hopefully in December we'll put it together. But for those who are really interested, it's something called New Clay, and I'll spell it as a clay with a K. So okay. New Clay with a K.
New Clay with a K. Well, I wanna stop there because I know there's so much more to talk about, but we've run out of time. But I know we have another interview, so we can pick it up from there. But I want to thank you so much for giving us all this really amazing information. I think you just have such a great passion about you and what you're doing, and you just have these really amazing ideas, and they just, you explain them so well. They make so much sense. And I really look forward to speaking to you next about this. But for now, I want to thank you so much for coming on the show today. I mean, I wish we had more time to talk more today, but I really look forward to our next interview.
All right. Great.
Thank you so much, Desirel. And I hope you have a great rest of your day. Thanks for taking the time out to speak with us today.
No problem. No problem.
Okay. Take care for now.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Yeah. In front of me. Can't see nothing coming up behind. Make my way through this darkness. I can't feel nothing but this chain that binds me. Lost track of how far I've gone. How far I've gone, how high I've climbed. On my back's a 60-pound stone. On my shoulder, half my